Peritoneal dialysis is recognized as a successful primary form of dialysis therapy, with outcomes equal to that of hemodialysis. In fact, there appears to be an initial survival advantage for incident patients on peritoneal dialysis relative to hemodialysis for the first 2 to 3 years. This survival advantage is most likely related to better preservation of residual renal function and improved volume and blood pressure control. Compared to hemodialysis, peritoneal dialysis therapy is associated with a lower prevalence of hepatitis C, improved renal transplant results, lower cost to perform, and greater patient autonomy and quality of life. However, peritoneal dialysis and hemodialysis should not be viewed as competitive therapies. Instead, both methods of dialysis should be considered as complementary. An integrative care approach is emerging whereby patients are started on peritoneal dialysis and timely transferred to hemodialysis when peritoneal dialysis-related problems arise. This strategy makes optimal use of each modality in the lifetime of a renal failure patient. Optimal long-term peritoneal catheter function is directly related to the skill of the catheter placement team. Proper placement of the catheter and postoperative care of the healing exit site are key to establishing a successful permanent peritoneal access. Catheter-related complications are major reasons why patients discontinue peritoneal dialysis. The initial 6 months and the success achieved during this period sets the stage for optimizing patient long-term participation in the peritoneal dialysis therapy. Catheter implantation is relatively simple, involving the creation of a controlled cutaneal peritoneal fistula with a catheter device that bridges the abdominal wall. Catheters can be implanted by open dissection through a small laparotomy incision or through a percutaneous puncture guided by laparoscopy. The two most commonly used dialysis catheters are a 2-cuff coil-tip tin-cuff style catheter and a 2-cuff coiled tip catheter with a permanent swan neck bend in the inner cuff segment. Straightened over a stylet, both kinds of catheters can be inserted through a laparoscopic port. Several factors are important for successful implantation of peritoneal dialysis catheters. Use of a 2-cuff catheter, a paramedian insertion site, rectus sheath tunneling to maintain pelvic orientation and prevent migration of the catheter tip. Locating the deep catheter cuff within the rectus sheath to reduce pericannular leaks and enhance tissue ingrowth. Locating the catheter tip deep in the pelvis to ensure drainage and keep omentum from interfering with the catheter. Performing a prophylactic omentopexy if redundant omentum threatens to interfere with the catheter. Performing a prophylactic adhesiolysis if the pelvic area is compartmentalized by scar tissue or other adhesions. A downwardly or laterally directed exit site to reduce the risk of exit site infection. Placing the superficial catheter cuff at least 2 centimeters from the exit wound. And using the smallest possible exit hole, which also helps to prevent infection. This program will introduce several techniques for peritoneal dialysis catheter implantation, along with variations for pre-sternal catheters, catheter burying procedures for secondary externalization, techniques for omentopexy and adhesiolysis, and post-operative care instructions. Proper function and care of the peritoneal catheter depends upon how it is positioned in the peritoneal cavity and abdominal wall. Ideal positioning is achieved through best practices for catheter choice and placement, which can be greatly aided by the use of pre-cut stencils during a thorough preoperative assessment. Using stencil-based preoperative mapping to help determine catheter selection creates accurate and reproducible connections between specific catheter design elements and vital anatomical landmarks. Those connections help determine the most appropriate catheter type, pelvic catheter tip position, and insertion and exit sites specific for each patient. The process of preoperative mapping for peritoneal access is similar to preoperative vascular mapping for hemodialysis, planning the most suitable access type and site to assure the best possible outcomes. Catheter dimensions and the point of insertion across the abdominal wall are two fundamental elements to consider in achieving both satisfactory dialysate flow function and a stable skin exit site. Current implementation techniques position the deep catheter cup at the musculofacial insertion site. Because the catheter length is finite, both internal and external, the deep cup's location is critical in determining the intraperitoneal span of the catheter tip and the range of reachable exit sites. The intraperitoneal catheter tip should be located beyond the reach of the omentum, toward the deep pelvis, but not too deep. Insertion too deep in the pelvis may cause pressure discomfort, early termination of dialysate outflow due to pelvic organ compression, or buckling of excessive catheter tubing out of the pelvis. For optimal placement of the catheter coil within the pelvis, the correct insertion site and deep cuff location is determined by aligning the upper border of the coil with the upper boundary of the true pelvis, as marked by the upper border of the pubic symphysis. Do not use the umbilicus to determine this location, because umbilicus levels above the pelvis vary greatly. Exit sites for the catheter tubing can be located in the lower abdomen, mid-abdomen, upper abdomen, or upper chest. When choosing a suitable exit site, look for a position that can be achieved by a lateral or downward direction of the subcutaneous tunnel and exit site, and provides minimal tubing shape memory stress. Location of the superficial cuff 2 to 4 centimeters from the exit wound. Avoidance of skin creases and folds, belt lines, and deforming scars. And a location away from problematic conditions such as yeast intertrigo, urinary or fecal incontinence, and intestinal stomas. In order to correctly assess the patient for the most appropriate catheter type, insertion site, and exit site, a preoperative exam must be conducted in advance of the surgery, with the patient fully dressed and in standing, sitting, and supine positions. This helps determine the locations of the belt line, skin creases, and folds, and reveals clinical conditions that might jeopardize the cleanliness of the catheter exit site. Using stencils that embody critical measurements of particular catheter devices greatly helps to standardize the process for preoperative assessment. Stencil-based catheter selection allows practitioners, such as peritoneal dialysis nursing staff, to perform the preoperative assessment and accurately communicate the preferred catheter type and insertion and exit site locations to the surgeon. The basic concepts for stencil design are applicable to any catheter type. This demonstration uses conventional Tenkoff catheters with a preformed swan neck arc bend and those with a straight intercuff segment.
This is a swan neck type of catheter with a preformed bend. In order to assure proper deep pelvic location of the catheter tip, we'll utilize the upper border of the pubic symphysis, which we'll indicate with a line. And then we'll align the upper coil with the border of the pubic symphysis and with the catheter in a perimedian location about 3 centimeters off of the midline. We'll indicate the upper border of the deep cuff, which corresponds to the catheter insertion site. We must precisely follow the preformed bend of the swan neck catheter, so we will indicate the exit site 2 to 3 centimeters superficial of the superficial cuff in line with the catheter limb, so that you don't have to do those type of geometric evaluations with the catheter. a stencil can be cut that reproduces this configuration, aligning the lower border of the stencil with the upper border of the pubic symphysis and the medial border of the stencil with the midline of the abdomen. You can indicate, as we can here, that the upper border of the deep cuff and the exit site can be determined, as we did with the catheter, using the stencil. For the Tinkoff style catheter, we have to take in consideration the shape memory of a straight tube bent into an arcuate configuration, because it wants to straighten out over time. So we come up with an algorithm that will allow us to designate a exit site that will prevent superficial cuff extrusion. So like we did for the swan neck, we will align the upper border of the coil tip with the upper border of the pubic symphysis, and then we'll mark the deep cuff location. This will correspond to our incision for the insertion side of the catheter that will produce a coil tip deep within the pelvis. Now, to design the tunnel track for this catheter, we will hold the deep cuff in the designated location, and then we'll use the catheter itself as a compass, ascribing an arc 2 centimeters cranial to the superficial cuff from the vertical plane all the way over to the lateral plane. And then we'll divide this arc between the medial 2/3 and the lateral third to indicate our exit site. And then putting the catheter back in this location, we will indicate a point 4 centimeters cranial to the superficial cuff, and we'll bend that catheter over so that it coincides with the selected exit site. And this should be the shape of our subcutaneous tunnel. And we should trace this on the abdomen. Now, to keep from having to do all of that, a stencil can be fashioned to accomplish the same thing, aligning the lower border of the stencil with the upper border of the pubic symphysis and the medial border with the midline of the abdomen. And with the stencil, be able to indicate the same entrance point and the selected exit site. And then, of course, we can have holes in the stencil to outline the same tunnel track configuration. And this greatly simplifies this instead of having to do all of the other geometry with the dialysis catheter itself.
Based on these concepts, a stencil can be produced for any catheter type. But catheter dimensions do vary from one type to another and from one manufacturer to another, so do not use the same stencil for all styles and brands. A stencil is accurate only for the catheter for which it is specifically constructed. Some medical device manufacturers provide stencils with their catheter products. If a stencil is not provided, it is easy to construct one using a catheter sample from the manufacturer and quilting template plastic found at most hobby or sewing supply stores. To create a stencil, measure the catheter sample to determine the distance between the upper borders of the coil and deep cuff. Then indicate the deep cuff cutout on the stencil plate. Use the catheter to indicate the shape of the subcutaneous tunnel and position of the exit site on the stencil, just as it was used to indicate the same items on the patient. When complete, the plastic stencil allows proper orientation on the body surface using the midline of the abdomen and upper border of the pubic symphysis. Subsequent chapters in this program will demonstrate stencil-based preoperative mapping for a variety of peritoneal catheter types. Standard abdominal catheters consisting of 2-cuff coiled tip catheters with either a straight or preformed intercuff arc bend are the most commonly used peritoneal access devices. Standard abdominal catheters provide for either a mid or low abdominal exit site location and may emerge above or below the level of the belt line. Appropriateness of standard abdominal catheters is determined using a preoperative evaluation. The patient should be fully dressed and examined in supine, sitting, and standing positions, looking for things that may interfere with catheter placement. These include body habitus, belt line location, presence of adult diapers, infective skin lesions, surgical scars, hernias, and stomas. Next, lie the patient down. Remove enough clothing to mark the belt line and upper border of the pubic symphysis. Have stencils ready for the available standard abdominal catheters. Note that some catheter manufacturers provide stencils that permit simultaneous marking of multiple catheter types on the same stencil plate. Position each of the stencils in turn on the abdominal wall. Align the medial border of the stencil with the midline of the abdomen. Adjust the stencil so that the cutout or mark for the pubis is superimposed over the scan mark of the pubic symphysis. Locate the exit site cutout on the stencil and mark it on the scan. Next, sit the patient up. The patient should be in a natural, relaxed sitting position. And examine the marked sites to determine which catheter types would produce a satisfactory exit location. A suitable exit site is clearly visible to the patient. Does not conflict with the belt line. Is not within a skin crease or on the blind side of a skin fold. Does not fall on the apex of a bulging or floppy skin fold. If any of the standard abdominal catheters provide a satisfactory exit site location, record the catheter type to be implanted. Stencil cutouts for the insertion incision and tunnel configuration do not have to be marked until the time of surgery. If none of the standard abdominal catheters provide acceptable exit sites, proceed to the program segment on preoperative mapping for an extended catheter system, which shows how to create an exit site in the upper abdomen or chest. Not infrequently, obese patients with large rotund abdominal contours or prominent lower abdominal skin folds may be unsuitable for standard abdominal catheters. Instead, an extended catheter that permits the exit site to be located in the relatively flat region of the upper abdomen may provide a better exit site location, one that is easier for the patient to see and take care of. An extended catheter is a two-piece catheter system with an abdominal catheter that attaches with a titanium connector to a subcutaneous extension segment. The extension reaches to a remote exit site away from the usual lower abdominal region. Assessment for an extended catheter is performed when it is readily apparent from the body habitus that standard abdominal catheters are unsuitable, or when preoperative mapping reveals that the patient will be better served with an exit site in the upper abdominal region. To begin the mapping process, prepare stencils for available two-piece extended catheters. The stencils include cutouts for the secondary incision, arcuate tunnel shape, and exit sites. With the patient in the sitting position, locate and mark the costal margin on the upper abdomen and the xiphoid process. Align the medial border of the stencil with the midline of the abdomen and mark the midline. Adjust the stencil up or down until the exit site cutout is in a position that is easily visible to the patient, does not conflict with the belt or bra line, is free of skin creases or the blind side of skin folds, and does not fall on the apex of a bulging or floppy skin fold. Mark the exit site and zero line, and confirm that the cutout for the subcutaneous arcuate tunnel does not conflict with the rib margin. If a suitable exit site cannot be obtained on the upper abdomen, proceed to assessment for an upper chest exit site location. Next, ask the patient to assume a flat supine position. Realign the stencil so that the exit site cutout is superimposed over the marked site. The medial border of the stencil should remain parallel to the midline, but may not always coincide with the midline due to lateral shift from the weight of the skin. Confirm again that the cutouts for the arcuate tunnel still do not conflict with the rib margin and mark the skin at the zero reference mark on the medial border of the stencil. Measure and record the distance from the zero reference point to the tip of the xiphoid process or to the upper border of the umbilical sinus. Finally, turn the stencil horizontal and measure and record the distance from the midline to the exit site mark. These two measurements will permit replication of the exit site location in the operating room. Note, too, that distinctive moles or scars can also be used as landmarks to locate the exit site. Measure and record the distance from the selected exit site to these distinguishing marks. On the day of the surgery, either in the preoperative holding area or in the operating room, mark the exit site using the measurements made during preoperative mapping. Superimpose the exit site cutout of the stencil over this point. Mark the secondary incision and subcutaneous tunnel pattern, including the superficial cuff location. Then position the stencil for the lower abdominal segment of the extended catheter on the abdominal wall. Align the medial border of the stencil with the midline of the abdomen. Adjust the stencil so that the cutout or mark for the pubis is superimposed over the skin mark of the pubic symphysis. Mark the primary incision site for the insertion of the intraperitoneal portion of the extended catheter system. Measure and record the distance between the primary and secondary incision. This measurement will be used to trim the catheters to appropriate length. This process will be described in the program chapter demonstrating implantation of an extended catheter to the upper abdomen. In some patients, the abdomen may be unsuitable for peritoneal dialysis catheter exit site because of obesity with overlapping skin folds, chronic yeast infections under the skin folds, urinary or fecal incontinence, or the presence of abdominal intestinal stomas. An extended catheter to the upper chest region is preferable for these individuals. In addition, patients who enjoy taking a deep tub bath can take advantage of an extended catheter with an upper chest exit site that remains above the waterline. An extended catheter is a two-piece catheter system in which an abdominal catheter is connected with a titanium connector to a subcutaneous extension segment that reaches an exit site away from the usual lower abdominal region. Assessment for an extended catheter is performed when preoperative mapping reveals that an exit site on the abdomen is unsuitable or clinical conditions exist that indicate that the patient will be better served with an upper chest exit site location. To begin the mapping process, prepare stencils for available two-piece extended catheters. The stencils have cutouts for the secondary incision, arcuate tunnel shape, and exit sites. Ask the patient to sit in a natural, relaxed position. Female patients should wear their normal bra style. First, identify and mark the suprasternal notch. Then locate and mark the clavicle and the location where the fleshy breast tissue ends. Position the stencil plate for the upper catheter segment over the upper chest and mark the midline. Then align the medial border of the stencil with the midline of the chest. Adjust the stencil up or down until the exit site cutout is away from the open collar area, above the fleshy or bulging part of the breast, and does not conflict with the bra line. Also, confirm that the cutouts for the subcutaneous arcuate tunnel do not conflict with the clavicle. The stencil design also assures that the exit site is off of the midline, out of the sternotomy zone, just in case the patient later requires cardiac surgery. Mark the skin at the exit site cutout. Then ask the patient to assume a flat supine position. Female patients should remove the bra. Realign the exit site cutout over the site marked on the skin. The medial border of the stencil should remain parallel to the midline, but may not exactly coincide with the midline because of lateral shift of the unsupported breast. Confirm again that the cutouts for the arcuate tunnel still do not conflict with the clavicle. If they do conflict, adjust the exit site and repeat the assessment, beginning with the patient sitting. Mark the skin at the zero reference mark of the stencil. Shift the stencil to the midline, keeping the zero reference point on the marked line. Measure and record the distance from the zero reference point to the jugular notch. Turn the stencil horizontal, keeping the zero reference point aligned with the intersection at the midline, and measure and record distance from the midline to the exit site mark. These two measurements will permit duplication of the exit site location in the operating room. Note, too, that distinctive moles or scars can also be used as landmarks to locate the exit site. Measure and record the distance from the selected exit site to these distinguishing marks. On the day of surgery, either in the preoperative holding area or in the operating room, mark the exit site using the measurements made during preoperative mapping. Superimpose the exit site cutout of the stencil over the second incision site and mark both it and the subcutaneous tunnel pattern, including the superficial cuff locations. Then position the stencil for the lower abdominal segment of the extended catheter on the abdominal wall. Align the medial border of the stencil with the midline of the abdomen. Adjust the stencil so that the cutout mark for the pubis is superimposed over the skin of the pubic symphysis. Mark the primary incision site for the insertion of the intraperitoneal portion of the extended catheter system. Measure and record the distance between the primary and secondary incisions. This measurement will be used to trim the catheters to the appropriate length. Trimming procedures will be described in the program chapter demonstrating implantation of an extended catheter to the upper chest. Laparoscopy has many advantages. The patient has less perioperative discomfort and an earlier return to full mobility. Catheter implantation can be performed on an ambulatory basis under local anesthesia. And there's a lower incidence of expensive to fix complications. Any patient that is a candidate for catheter insertion by open dissection is a candidate for laparoscopic implantation. The big advantage of laparoscopic implantation is that it allows the surgeon to see and proactively address, at the time of implantation, problems that might affect catheter outcomes. These include catheter tip migration, omental entrapment, and peritoneal adhesions. To begin, on the side opposite the catheter insertion site, create the site for the laparoscope port, which will also serve as the point of initial introduction for the varus needle. This incision should be far enough away from the paramedian site to avoid port conflict and to provide good visibility of the implantation process. So don't use the paraumbilical area because it's too close to the paramedian site. If the procedure is performed under local anesthesia, ask the patient to tense and protrude the abdominal wall to create a rigid platform, which helps insert the varus needle. Aspirate and flush the varus needle with saline. Connect a gas line to create the pneumoperitoneum and put the patient in the Trendelenburg position. After the abdomen is inflated, insert the camera port and then the camera. After the camera is inserted, explore the pelvic area, looking for problems that could compromise catheter function. These include undiagnosed abdominal wall hernias, redundant omentum filling the pelvis, and adhesions that compartmentalize the lower abdomen. Also, if possible, note the position of the inferior epigastric vessels to avoid injury when placing the catheter.
Next, make a 2-centimeter transverse perimedian incision at the predetermined site. Expose the rectus sheath by blunt spreading dissection with a combination of hemostat clamps and narrow ribbon retractors. Make a small pinpoint hole in the anterior rectus sheath with a cautery device. Push the varus needle and sheath gently through the pinpoint fascial hole and rectus muscle in perpendicular fashion. You can see the blunt tip of the needle through the laparoscope as it tints down the posterior rectus sheath and peritoneum. Angle the needle toward the pelvis and observe as it slides down the posterior rectus sheath. To determine the tunnel length, pass a locator needle through the abdominal wall, a known distance caudal to the perimedian incision. Push the varus needle through the peritoneal membrane into the abdominal cavity at the desired distance. Then remove the varus needle and insert the dilator cannula through the expandable sleeve, completing the catheter port insertion. Because the Dacron cuffs of commercially available peritoneal dialysis catheters will not pass through a port smaller than 7 millimeters, use a 7 to 8 millimeter port system with a 5 millimeter reducer cap. Then, to make room for the 7 millimeter cuffs, modify the cap by making 2 incisions in the rubber membrane, 180 degrees apart. These incisions won't affect the airtight seal around the catheter tubing. Prior to implantation, soak the catheter tubing and flush the lumen with saline to remove particulates. Then squeeze air bubbles from the Dacron cuffs to promote better tissue ingrowth. Straighten the catheter by inserting a stylet, which also makes it easier to pass through the port device. Under laparoscopic control, advance the catheter stylet assembly through the catheter port to its destination in the pelvic retrovesicle space. Locating the catheter deep within the pelvis helps to keep the omentum from blocking the catheter tip. To make sure the deep cuff is passed through the anterior rectus sheath, advance the catheter until the cuff is visible within the peritoneal cavity. Then withdraw the port from the abdominal wall up onto the shaft of the catheter stylet assembly. Under laparoscopic control, withdraw the catheter stylet assembly so the Dacron cuff just disappears above the peritoneum and settles just below the anterior rectus sheath. Be careful, though, not to pull the cuff out of the sheath because it's difficult to replace the cuff into the rectus sheath through the tight fascial hole left by the port. Remove the stylet from the catheter, then allow the pneumoperitoneum to deflate and remove the laparoscope, leaving the scope's port in place. Next, with the abdomen contour normal again, construct the subcutaneous tunnel path and catheter exit site. To make sure the opening at the exit site is as snug as possible, use a tunneling guide, such as a Faller stylet, that does not exceed the diameter of the tubing and which can be passed from the perimedian incision to the exit site. Do not tunnel from the exit site toward the perimedian incision because it can drive skin bacteria into the tunnel tract. Next, attach the stylet to the catheter and secure it with suture thread. Use the stylet to pull the catheter through the subcutaneous tunnel and out the exit site. Then tuck the cuff into the insertion site and check its final resting spot. Finally, attach the catheter adapter and transfer set to the catheter so it doesn't have to be done later in a less sterile environment. At this point, even with the laparoscopic control, it's good to perform a trial irrigation of the catheter to identify potential problems caused by omentum, epigloic appendages, and fimbriae of the uterine tubes. With a patient in reverse Trendelenburg position, inject a standard 1-liter bag of heparinized saline and check for unimpeded inflow and drainage by gravity. At the end of the trial irrigation, leave 250 to 300 milliliters of fluid in the abdomen to reduce the likelihood of intraperitoneal structures sucking up against the catheter toward the end of the drainage process. While the irrigation is running, you can save time by closing the primary surgical wound and applying dressings. Close subcutaneous layers of the skin with 3-0 polygalactic sutures, and use 4-0 polygalactic sutures for the intracuticular closure. Apply tincture of benzoin around the skin incisions. Cover the exit site with a biopatch, and support the closed wounds with sterile adhesive strips. Anchor the catheter system. And finally, cover the wounds with sterile gauze and a sterile dressing. After a successful irrigation, flush the entire system with 20 milliliters of heparin to prevent fibrin plugging the catheter, and cap the catheter. Then remove the laparoscopic port and close the port incision. No fascial closure is needed for port wounds less than 5 millimeters. Finally, stabilize the wound with tincture of benzoin and sterile adhesive strips. Cover with gauze and a sterile dressing. And finally, replace the catheter cap to finish the procedure. Obstructed flow is the most common problem threatening peritoneal dialysis catheters. An omental entrapment of the catheter is a common cause of flow problems. If redundant thin filmy omentum is filling the pelvis, it could interfere with the catheter tip and should be prophylactically tacked to the upper abdomen. This procedure, called an omentopexy, can be performed either before or after the catheter is implanted. To begin, insert a working port in the pararectus location on the same side as the camera port. Insert a grasping forceps through the working port and use it to pull the redundant omentum into the upper abdomen. Make a 1 to 1.5 centimeter incision in the upper abdominal quadrant, lateral to the rectus sheath and below the costal margin. Use a spring-loaded guarded hook needle with an attached 0 polygalactic suture to tack the omentum to the abdominal wall. Advance the tacking needle with the suture through the abdominal wall under laparoscopic vision. Then use a grasping forceps to help skewer multiple folds of redundant omentum with the needle, being careful to avoid omental blood vessels. Remove the suture from the needle with a grasping forceps and withdraw the needle from the abdominal wall. Then reinsert the needle through the same skin incision, but in a slightly different abdominal wall location to retrieve the suture thread from the forceps. Pull the suture out through the skin incision, which also pulls the omentum to the abdominal wall, and then tie the suture to complete the procedure. Omentopexy is a simple, quick, and inexpensive addition to the catheter implantation surgery and significantly improves outcomes. It adds only about 10 minutes of working time, requires just one additional working port and 2 small skin incisions, and increases surgical costs by less than $100. Adhesions from previous abdominal surgery may involve the parietal peritoneum at the catheter insertion site, or form intraperitoneal compartments that can contribute to poor drainage. When the lesions are detected laparoscopically, the lower abdominal cavity and pelvis can be restored to open space by performing an adhesiolysis. The procedure is performed through an additional 5 millimeter working port with laparoscopic scissors, cautery, or an ultrasonic shears. If the procedure is conducted under local anesthesia and the adhesions aren't too extensive, adhesiolysis can be performed with minimal additional discomfort to the patient. Do note, however, that not every adhesion needs to be mobilized. For example, omentum adhering to the abdominal wall above the level of the pelvis won't interfere with fluid drainage from the upper abdomen and may even protect the catheter from omental entrapment. Thank you. Currently, open dissection is the most common method of peritoneal access for dialysis catheter implantation. The procedure can be performed under local or general anesthesia. Open dissection permits visual confirmation of entry into the peritoneal cavity. But exploration of the abdominal cavity is restricted to what can be seen or felt through a small hole in the peritoneum, and the catheter is advanced mostly by feel, blindly, into the peritoneal cavity. To begin, mark the pubic symphysis. Then use stencils to mark the insertion site, tunnel tract, and exit site. Next, make a 5 to 8 centimeter paramedian incision through the skin and subcutaneous tissues, exposing the rectus sheath where you want to locate the deep catheter cuff. Incise the anterior rectus sheath and split the muscle parallel with its fibers to expose the posterior rectus sheath. To create the peritonotomy, place a purse-string suture of zero polygalactic absorbable material through both the posterior rectus sheath and the peritoneum. Be careful to avoid puncturing the bowel or accidentally including the omentum in the stitch. Lift up the posterior rectus sheath and peritoneum with a forceps. Then make a 0.5 centimeter incision with Metzenbaum scissors or scalpel to enter the peritoneal cavity. Elevate the peritoneum and fascia to create an airspace between the parietal and underlying viscera. Next, advance the catheter, straightened over an internal stylet, through the peritoneal incision toward the pelvis until the deep cuff abuts the posterior fascia. If you feel resistance during the insertion, withdraw the catheter and redirect it until it advances easily. After the catheter is placed, withdraw the stylet completely and tie the purse string suture. Pass the catheter tubing and superficial cuff through the anterior rectus sheath, at least 2.5 centimeters cranial to the level of the purse string suture and deep cuff location. If the anterior rectus sheath was opened with a transverse incision, perform the oblique tunneling using a clamp to pull the catheter through a small hole in the anterior fascia, above the fascial incision. If the rectus sheath was opened vertically, pass the catheter between two fascial sutures at the most cranial end of the incision. Next, create the subcutaneous tunnel with a tool, such as a Faller stylet, that does not exceed the diameter of the catheter. This ensures the smallest exit site that still permits passage of the catheter tubing. Larger wounds, created by tunneling with hemostat clamps and other oversized instruments, can increase the risk of infection, peritonitis, and catheter loss. Attach the catheter to the stylet. Tie it in place. Then pull the catheter through the subcutaneous tissue and out the exit site. Remove the stylet and draw the superficial cuff into the tunnel until it rests at the designated location, within 2 to 4 centimeters of the exit site. To finish the procedure, tubing attachments and flow testing follow the same procedures as described for the laparoscopic implantation technique. An extended two-piece catheter with an upper abdominal exit site is used when the lower abdominal region is unable to provide an acceptable skin exit location. The extended catheter system consists of an abdominal catheter segment joined to an extension segment with a titanium connector. Depending on the manufacturer, the extension segment is equipped with either two cuffs or a single superficial cuff and an internal marker ring. The extended catheter provides enough length to reach the upper abdominal regions without sacrificing deep pelvic location of the catheter tip. Indications for an upper abdominal catheter include obesity, urinary or fecal incontinence, occupational activities with mechanical pressure over the lower abdomen, or inability to achieve a satisfactory lower abdominal exit site location with a conventional catheter because of conflicts with the belt line, skin creases, skin folds, or other abdominal wall deformities.
For details and preoperative assessment for extended catheters, please see the program chapter describing preoperative mapping for upper abdominal exit sites. In the operating room or in the preoperative holding area before surgery, mark the upper abdominal exit site using the measurements recorded during preoperative mapping. After marking the exit site, superimpose the exit site cutout of the stencil over this point and trace the patterns for the secondary incision, the subcutaneous tunnel track, and the location of the superficial cuff. Mark the upper border of the pubic symphysis. Then align the stencil for the lower abdominal segment with the midline of the abdomen. Adjust the stencil so that the cutout mark for the pubis is superimposed over the skin mark for the pubic symphysis. Mark the primary incision site for insertion of the intraperitoneal portion of the extended catheter system. Measure and record the distance between the primary and secondary incision. Be sure to hold the measuring tape taut over the torso. Do not allow the tape to follow the body contour. Instead, the measurement should represent the straight distance between the primary and secondary incision sites. After appropriate surgical skin preparation and application of sterile drapes, implant the lower abdominal catheter using either the laparoscopic or open dissection. The open technique is described in another chapter of this program. For the laparoscopic approach, place the patient into Trendelenburg position and insert the varus needle in the upper quadrant, below the costal margin at the lateral border of the rectus sheath. Insufflate the abdomen. Replace the varus needle with a 5 mm port. Insert the laparoscope and explore the peritoneal cavity for redundant omentum, adhesions, and abdominal wall hernias. Make an incision at the primary site. Expose the anterior rectus sheath by blunt dissection with a combination of peon clamps, narrow ribbon retractors, and peanut sponge dissector. Make a pinhole in the anterior rectus sheath with the cautery. Under laparoscopic guidance, tunnel a 7 to 8 mm port system through the rectus sheath for 6 cm before entry into the peritoneal cavity. With the abdominal catheter straightened over a stylet, pass it through the port under laparoscopic control. Withdraw the stylet and catheter port and retract the catheter until the deep cuff is just below the anterior rectus sheath. Using a 0-polyglycolic acid suture on a UR6 needle, place a purse string around the catheter at the level of the anterior rectus sheath to minimize the risk of pericatheter leak. Make a secondary incision at the marked site. Expose the anterior rectus sheath by blunt dissection using a combination of peon clamps, narrow ribbon retractors, and peanut sponge dissector. Perform blunt finger dissection on the surface of the rectus fascia for the upper end of the subcutaneous tunnel, and then create a subcutaneous pocket on the surface of the fascia cranial of the incision for the arcuate bin of the extension catheter. The next step will be trimming and joining the abdominal and extension catheters. For upper abdominal catheter systems, the distance between the primary and secondary incisions, designated here as distance A, is generally much shorter than the length of the extension catheter, either from the upper border of the Dacron cuff to the end of the tubing in two cuff devices, or from the marker ring to the end of the tubing in one cuff devices. This means a length of tubing will need to be trimmed from both the extension and lower abdominal catheters in order to correctly span the distance between the primary and secondary incisions. The length of the tubing trimmed from each component is arbitrary, but the combined lengths of the extension catheter, B, and the lower catheter, C, must equal the distance, A, between the primary and secondary incisions. A measuring rod supplied by some catheter manufacturers or similar straight edge for measuring will be used to trim the lower abdominal catheter a determined length, C, above the level of the fascia. The extension catheter is trimmed at the computed length, B, below the upper border of the Dacron cuff of one limb of two cuff extensions or below the marker ring in one cuff extensions. Following these steps in measuring and trimming the catheter will assure correct connecting lengths and avoid costly mistakes of cutting the tubing too short or leaving redundant tubing that may kink. Again, begin the catheter trimming by inserting a measuring rod alongside the abdominal tubing to the level of the fascia. Cut the catheter the determined length above the level of the fascia, making sure to leave enough length above the skin level to insert the titanium connector. Place the measuring rod alongside the extension tube and trim the upper catheter to the computed length. Insert the titanium connector into the catheter ends and secure them with 2-0 polypropylene sutures tied over the connector grooves of both catheter segments and then to each other. Advance a tunneling rod on the surface of the thoracoabdominal fascia from the primary to the secondary incision. The tunneling rod may be supplied by the catheter manufacturer, or, if not, use a suitable vascular tunneler. A Randall stone forceps may be used if the tunnel is short, inserting it from the secondary incision down to the primary incision to pull the catheter up. Retaining the pneumoperitoneum during this maneuver helps with tunneling on the surface of the abdominal fascia. Attach the catheter to the tunneler. Then carefully pull the tunneler through the secondary incision, with care to keep the guide stripe on the catheter straight as it is pulled up into the subcutaneous track. Continue to pull the catheter gently until the Dacron cuff or marker ring on the measured limb is visible at the secondary incision site. Detach the tunneling rod. Next, create the exit site using a tunneling tool, such as a Faller stylet, which does not exceed the diameter of the tubing and which can be passed from the secondary incision through the skin without making a prior incision. This creates the smallest hole possible, keeping the skin snug around the catheter. Attach the catheter to the stylet and secure it with a suture tie. Pull the stylet and catheter through the exit site. Remove the stylet. Without ratcheting it closed, use a peon clamp to gently set the superficial cuff into the subcutaneous track, 2 to 3 centimeters from the exit wound, to complete the catheter placement. From this point, closure, testing, dressings, and postoperative care are the same as for standard abdominal closures. Please see the standard wound closure and dressing segment of this program for descriptions of those steps. An extended catheter to the upper chest, sometimes called a presternal catheter, is used when an exit site on the abdominal wall is unacceptable. This two-piece extended catheter system includes an abdominal catheter joined to a subcutaneous extension tube with a titanium connector. Depending on the manufacturer, the extension segment is provided with either 2 cuffs or a single superficial cuff and an internal marker ring. The extended catheter provides enough length to reach the upper chest region without sacrificing deep pelvic location of the catheter tip. The upper chest exit site reduces catheter-related infections in high-risk patients who might not otherwise be candidates for peritoneal dialysis. Indications include obesity, overlapping skin folds, yeast intertrigo, urinary or fecal incontinence, presence of intestinal stomas, or a patient who wants to be able to take deep tub baths after the catheter is implanted. For details on preoperative assessment for extended catheters, please see the segment of this program describing preoperative mapping for upper chest exit sites. In the operating room or in the preoperative holding area, mark the chest exit site using the measurements recorded during the preoperative mapping. After marking the exit site, superimpose the exit site cutout of the stencil over this point, and trace the patterns for the secondary incision, the subcutaneous tunnel track, and the location of the superficial cuff. Mark the upper border of the pubic symphysis. Then align the stencil for the lower abdominal segment with the midline of the abdomen. Adjust the stencil so that the cutout or mark for the pubis is superimposed over the skin mark for the pubic symphysis. Mark the primary incision site for insertion of the intraperitoneal portion of the extended catheter system. Measure and record the distance between the primary and secondary incision. Be sure to keep the measuring tape taut over the torso. Do not allow the tape to follow the body and/or breast contours, because the measurement should represent the straight distance between the primary and secondary incision sites. After appropriate surgical skin preparation and application of sterile drapes, implant the lower abdominal catheter using either the laparoscopic or open dissection approach. The open technique is described in another chapter of this program. For the laparoscopic approach, place the patient into the Trendelenburg position and insert the varus needle in the upper abdominal quadrant, below the costal margin at the lateral border of the rectus sheath. Insufflate the abdomen. Replace the varus needle with a 5 mm port. Insert the laparoscope and explore the peritoneal cavity for redundant omentum, adhesions, and abdominal wall hernias. Make an incision at the primary site. Expose the anterior rectus sheath by blunt dissection using a combination of peon clamps, narrow ribbon retractors, and peanut sponge dissector. Start the subcutaneous tunnel for the extension catheter with blunt finger dissection on the surface of the fascia. Make a pinhole in the anterior rectus sheath with the cautery. Under laparoscopic guidance, tunnel a 7 to 8 mm port system through the rectus sheath for 6 centimeters before entry into the peritoneal cavity. With the abdominal catheter straightened over a stylet, pass it through the port under laparoscopic control. Withdraw the stylet and catheter port and retract the catheter until the deep cuff is just below the anterior rectus sheath. Using a 0-polyglycolic acid suture on a UR6 needle, place a purse string around the catheter at the level of the anterior rectus sheath to minimize the risk of pericatheter leak. Incise the skin at the secondary incision site. Expose the pectoralis fascia by blunt dissection using a combination of peon clamps, narrow ribbon retractors, and peanut sponge dissector. Perform blunt finger dissection on the surface of the pectoralis fascia on the retromammary space for the upper end of the subcutaneous tunnel. Then create a subcutaneous pocket on the surface of the fascia, cranial to the incision, for the arcuate bend of the extension catheter. The next step will be trimming and joining the abdominal and extension catheters. For upper chest catheter systems, the distance between the primary and secondary incision sites, designated here as distance A, is generally longer than the length of the extension catheter, B, from the upper border of the Dacron cuff to the end of the tubing in two cuff devices, or from the marker ring to the end of the tubing in one cuff extensions. This means that, in most cases, only the lower abdominal catheter, C, will need trimming for the system to correctly span the distance between the primary and secondary incisions. The distance between the primary and secondary incisions, A, minus the length B of the extension tube from the upper border of the Dacron cuff to the end of the tubing, or alternatively, from the marker ring to the end of the tubing, equals the length C that should remain on the lower abdominal segment above the fascia. Using a measuring rod supplied by some catheter manufacturers or similar straight edge for measuring, the lower abdominal catheter will be trimmed the computed length, C, above the level of the fascia. Following these steps in measuring and trimming the catheter will assure correct connecting lengths and avoid costly mistakes of cutting the tubing too short or leaving redundant tubing that may kink. Again, to begin the trimming, insert a measuring rod alongside the abdominal catheter to the level of the fascia. Trim the abdominal catheter at the computed length. Insert the titanium connector into the catheter ends and secure them with 2-0 polypropylene sutures tied over the connector grooves of both catheter segments and then to each other. Advance a tunneling rod on the surface of the thoracoabdominal fascia from the primary to the secondary incision. The tunneling instrument may be supplied by the catheter manufacturer, or if not, use a suitable vascular tunneler. Retaining the pneumoperitoneum during this maneuver helps with tunneling on the surface of the abdominal fascia. Attach the catheter to the tunneler. Carefully pull the tunneler through the secondary incision, being careful to keep the guide stripe on the catheter straight as it is pulled up into the subcutaneous tract. Detach the tunneling rod. Continue to pull the catheter gently until the Dacron cuff or marker ring on the measured limb is visible at the secondary incision site, which it will be if the measurements and trimming were performed correctly. Next, create the exit site using a tunneling tool, such as a Fowler stylet, which does not exceed the diameter of the tubing. The stylet can be passed from the secondary incision through the skin without making a prior incision. This creates the smallest hole possible, leaving the skin snug around the catheter. Attach the catheter to the stylet and secure it with a suture tie. Pull the stylet and catheter through the exit site. Then remove the stylet. Without ratcheting it closed, use a peon clamp to gently set the superficial cuff into the subcutaneous tract, 2 to 3 centimeters from the exit wound. This completes the catheter placement. From this point, closure, testing, dressings, and post-operative care is the same as for standard abdominal catheters. Please see the sections of this program describing those steps. The peritoneal dialysis catheter embedding procedure, also known as the Moncrief-Popovich technique, is a strategy of implanting the peritoneal dialysis catheter far in advance of anticipated need and leaving the external limb of the catheter tubing embedded under the skin in the subcutaneous tissues. Exteriorization of the catheter is delayed until the patient needs to initiate dialysis, which can be weeks, months, or even years later. The advantages of this technique are that the catheter heals in the sterile subcutaneous environment without exposure to potential contamination from the exit site. There is greater patient acceptance for earlier commitment to peritoneal dialysis when placing catheters ahead of time. It reduces the nursing workload and cost of supplies to maintain an unused catheter. Exteriorization of a healed catheter enables immediate full-dose peritoneal dialysis without a break-in period. It is an excellent strategy to avoid urgent temporary hemodialysis with a tunneled vascular catheter. And it allows more efficient scheduling of catheter placement as a planned, non-urgent surgery, which reduces stress on operating room access. There is no advantage to embedding the catheter if use is expected within 3 to 5 weeks. Timing of catheter placement with embedding should aim for a window of 5 weeks to 6 months prior to anticipated need. The catheter embedding procedure can be performed in conjunction with any catheter implantation approach or catheter type. Perform the catheter implantation as you normally would up to the point of tunneling it through the eventual exit site. The catheter is always temporarily brought out through the future exit site. The exit site scar will serve as the landmark to come back to for delayed exteriorization of the embedded catheter. Prior to embedding, it's important to demonstrate satisfactory flow function of the catheter. This technique is described in the Testing Catheter Function section of this program. Begin the embedding procedure by planning the path of the subcutaneous bed. The subcutaneous track should always be straight or curvilinear to facilitate pulling the catheter from the subcutaneous bed at the time of the exteriorization procedure. Do not cross the midline. For lower abdominal catheters, direct the subcutaneous track in a curvilinear path down and across the lower abdomen, stopping at the midline. In the lower abdomen, the catheter tubing may need to be shortened to avoid conflict with the subcutaneous track and the pubis. For extended upper abdominal catheters, direct the subcutaneous track in a curvilinear path down and across the lower abdomen, stopping at the midline. Many times, the path can be directed back to the primary insertion incision, thereby eliminating the need for an additional incision. Finally, for extended upper chest catheters, direct the subcutaneous track straight down the chest in a parasternal path to the epigastrium. To begin, lay the catheter on the skin in a straight or curvilinear fashion. Mark the lower end of the track. Trace the planned subcutaneous path from the future exit site to the mark at the end of the track. In contrast to primary exteriorization of the catheter, where it's important to make the smallest skin hole possible, the embedding procedure requires a 1 centimeter incision at the future exit site to accommodate both the catheter and the embedding stylet. Make a 1/2 centimeter incision at the lower end of the embedding track. Insert the embedding stylet at the lower incision and advance it deep into the subcutaneous tissues in a retrograde fashion. Toward the future exit site incision, direct the stylet more superficially so that it emerges from the incision a few millimeters below the dermis. This leaves the embedded catheter close to the skin at the future exit site to make it easier to locate during delayed exteriorization. Flush the catheter with heparin solution. Here, we use 5,000 units of heparin diluted in 20 milliliters of saline. Insert the plug end of the embedding tool into the catheter. Secure the plug with a 2-0 silk tie. Gently retract the embedding stylet, pulling the catheter through the subcutaneous track. Detach the embedding stylet from the plug. Close the blind threaded end of the plug with the provided cap. Push the plugged end of the catheter into the subcutaneous track. Then close all the incisions and apply sterile dressings.
When it's time to exteriorize the buried catheter, prep and drape the patient as you would for implantation. But be careful when injecting the local anesthesia not to puncture the catheter tubing. Make a small incision, 0.5 to 0.75 centimeters through or near the previous secondary incision scar. And use a hemostat to dissect down to the catheter and lift it up and out through the skin. Because there will be tissue ingrowth into the superficial cuff, you can apply gentle traction when pulling on the catheter without worrying about displacing the deeper portion of the catheter. When the catheter end is freed, unplug the tubing. Attach an adapter and transfer set, and check the catheter with a saline flush. Do not use sutures to repair the exit site. But to minimize movement and promote healing, do immobilize the catheter with tincture of benzoin and sterile adhesive strips. Then dress the site as you would for a newly implanted catheter. Full-volume peritoneal dialysis can begin immediately without risk of pericannular leaks. After the catheter is implanted, it's important to check flow function before finalizing the procedure. During laparoscopic implantations, test flow function after the tunnel tract and exit site construction. In non-laparoscopic procedures, check flow function before exteriorizing the catheter through the exit site. This helps prevent trauma to the tunnel tract and exit site if the catheter needs to be repositioned. To begin, attach the adapter and transfer set to the catheter. Then, with the patient in reverse Trendelenburg position, observe a standard 1-liter bag of heparinized saline for unimpeded inflow and drainage by gravity. While the saline drains, you can save time by closing the primary surgical wound and applying dressings. At the end of the flow test, leave 250 to 300 milliliters of fluid in the abdomen to reduce the likelihood of intraperitoneal structures sucking up against the catheter. If poor flow occurs during a laparoscopic implantation, look for omental wrap, epicloic appendices, or fimbriae of uterine tubes. It may be possible to resolve the problems without disturbing the catheter. After a successful irrigation, close and dress the remaining wounds using standard procedures. In laparoscopic procedures, wound closure can begin while a trial irrigation of the catheter is running. Close subcutaneous layers of the skin wounds with 3-0 polygalactic sutures. Then use 4-0 polygalactic sutures for the intracuticular skin closure. Apply tincture of benzoin around the skin incisions. Cover the exit site with a biopatch. And support the closed wounds with sterile adhesive strips. Anchor the catheter system. And finally, cover the wounds with sterile gauze. And cover the gauze with the sterile water impenetrable but oxygen and moisture vapor permeable dressing. After the irrigation is complete, flush the system with 20 milliliters of heparin. And cap the catheter. Then remove the camera port and close the port incision. No fascial closure is needed for port wounds less than 5 millimeters. Stabilize the wound with tincture of benzoin and sterile adhesive strips. Then dress the wound with sterile gauze and a sterile dressing. And replace the catheter's protective cap with a povidone iodine impregnated mini cap. The goal of postoperative care is to prevent infection and maintain a healthy, clean catheter exit site and healthy surrounding tissue. The first step is to perform an in-and-out flush of the catheter with 1 liter of heparinized saline. This is done within 72 hours after surgery and repeated weekly until peritoneal dialysis begins. The flushing procedure is performed according to CAPD exchange guidelines to maintain sterility of the fluid path and peritoneal cavity. During the procedure, the nurse must also adhere to basic aseptic procedures, including close the door to the room where the procedure is performed. All people in the room must wear masks. Wash with antibacterial soap. Wear gloves. And discard supplies according to hospital policies or home training protocols.
Okay, Mr. Leon, we're going to go ahead and flush your catheter with the heparinized saline that I told you about. This will prevent any clotting in or around the tip of the catheter during the 2 to 3 week postoperative period.
Okay.
To flush the catheter, infuse 1 liter of heparinized saline, warm to body temperature, at a rate of 200 to 250 milliliters per minute. Allow the solution to drain immediately, observing the flow rate and looking for heavy fibrin or red blood cells. If blood clots do appear, repeat the flush with a fresh bag of heparinized saline. At the end of the flush, leave the last 100 cc's of the solution in the patient's abdominal cavity, and replace the catheter's mini-cap to finish the procedure. For proper dressing maintenance, do not remove the exit site dressing for the first 7 days after surgery. During this period, the dressing should remain clean, dry, and intact. If the dressing becomes soiled or loose, contact the dialysis nurse for further instructions. For the first few weeks, the patient should not shower, bathe, or swim. The patient can resume showering 1 month after surgery if there have been no complications in wound healing. But it's still a good idea to keep a sterile gauze dressing over the exit site as it heals. If there's no excessive drainage, the dialysis nurse will change the dressings weekly for 2 weeks, and then the patient can begin a routine of daily exit site cleansing with antibacterial soap. Each time the dressing is removed, inspect the site for drainage, signs of infection, and the appearance of the catheter. If there are no problems and the wounds are healing well, then clean around the site with normal saline. Pat it dry with sterile gauze, apply a new biopatch, and cover the wounds with a new Viasorb dressing. Finally, apply a label that provides instructions to call the peritoneal dialysis nurse if there are any problems, and contact information for doing so.